For nearly 30 years, Jamaica's second largest city, Montego Bay, has been home to one of the greatest reggae and dancehall festivals in the world, Reggae Sumfest. Reggae and dancehall fans travel from around the world to experience Jamaica's music, food, culture, beaches, and tropical lifestyle. But if you're in Jamaica around mid-July, you might have to add Sumfest to your to-do list. My team and I are in Jamaica this week to witness the preparation of the festival and its economic impact on the city of Montego Bay. It is 85 degrees in Jamaica. We are 36 hours from the highly anticipated two-day reggae festival, Reggae Sumfest. Over 1,000 workmen employed to erect chateau-like structures built to last a century, but taken down in only 2 days. And its CEO, Joe Bogdanovich, is not far from the action.
In 2019, we brought in over $10 million to the city of Montego Bay. And that puts people to work and putting their kids through school and something, you know, something to look forward to as a way to earn money. And when we closed our deal, well, we closed our deal here. We got a lease here for 30 years and we're looking to bring several kinds of music entertainment here to Jamaica.
Reggae Sumfest started back in 1993 by a group of Montego Bay businessmen who saw the need to continue a reggae show after the previous event, Reggae Sunsplash, was discontinued.
Reggae Sumfest is the largest music festival in Jamaica and the Caribbean.
Business is great. I love it, man. Bring up for this time of year. Great. We make a lot of money, you know?
Yeah. Where are you
from? From Melbourne, Australia.
And what's your name?
My name's James.
And what brought you to Jamaica?
Sumfest and just reggae music.
Wednesday morning to all those well-pleased chilling out in the West Indies. So, you know, Sumfest is definitely on all of our minds.
The show, the festival, had become a calendar event and remains the greatest reggae festival in the world. And I can say this having attended many other festivals throughout the world. I know that Reggae Sumfest is the greatest.
Reggae Sumfest started in 1993.
By now, 1997, dancehall will be the top music in the world.
And has brought many international artists to Jamaica, such as Beyonce, Usher, Toni Braxton, Chris Brown, and many others.
The expense of bringing in foreign acts. And when we look at the viability of it, if we continue to bring foreign acts, and the entire thing had to be changed to create more attractive local business. And whilst we're in that period of trying to come up with an alternative modus operandi, an offer was made to us by the current operators. And when we looked at the offer, we said, what the hell, we have done enough. Let us sell. They have decided to restrict it to the Jamaican performance, which we were looking at the time, and they have done well. And if it were not for COVID, they would have continued to grow. And I'm sure this year they will be having a tremendous festival. They have done very, very well. I would do it again. As a matter of fact, sometimes we a couple of us say, maybe we should not have sold it. Maybe we should not have sold it, but we sold it.
American businessman Joe Bogdanovich is the new sheriff in town. Since 2016, after the involvement of Bogdanovich, the festival has been focusing only on the local reggae and dancehall acts of Jamaica.
Now, we didn't need to import big-name artists to attract people to the show, because a lot of overseas patronage just wanted reggae. And we were busy bringing, you name it. I mean, there's no top American act that we didn't bring, including Rihanna. So we went with local talent because, as I said, we were of the opinion that our local talent could stand up to scrutiny and also would be popular enough to attract overseas visitors as well as local patronage, you know.
Downtown wanted a reggae festival true to the roots of Jamaica and the music, and thought it best not to use overseas non-reggae artists in order to draw people. And again, it's a learning curve. People were expecting it in year one, and they've grown to understand that they won't come here and see a non-reggae act, because this is Reggae Sumfest.
The thing is, when you book an international act and you book a Jamaican act, even if you're paying the Jamaican artist a substantial amount of money, chances are that artist lives in Jamaica. So the money remains in Jamaica and it will benefit the economy of Jamaica. When you book an A-list artist from the US, those artists within a day or so, they're looking to leave Jamaica to go back to the US. In fact, when Celine Dion was paid $1 million, she reportedly, she didn't even remain in the country 24 hours. So she came in, performed, and she left less than 24 hours. So all that money left Jamaica immediately. So it really didn't, none of it was spent in Jamaica to help the economy of Jamaica. I'll bend me a deal, man.
And when the old Jamaica stop bleach them face. I would say, I don't see where Reggae Sumfest made any major errors bringing in a number of international artists who were well recognized and were good for the show. The festival was growing. Those are some of the things that propelled the festival. Now there's a possibility that we don't necessarily need those types of names in order for this festival to live on. And what the new team has really shown us is that reggae has its own strength. It can stand on its own. It can elevate to the extent that we can have a festival that garners the same amount of people, the same kind of support, without having international access.
I think it's a great decision to let local acts shine, because it is a reggae festival, you know, and Jamaica, when it gets back to its full spectrum of festivals, now that we're more or less post-COVID, there are places for those artists to perform. But I think for a Reggae Sumfest, it's really prudent to have Jamaican artists as the headliners, Jamaican artists as the opening acts, Jamaican artists in every facet.
The economic impact is one of the many benefits of the festival. For some, it is a means of survival.
Yes, Sumfest for me, back in the earlier part of 2000 when just started, it helped me to send back my children to school. Yeah, and any other bills may have to clear up, like light bill and water bill, it does clear up. If me owe anybody, clear up.
This year is better for us, because we have more accent as a hustler, and you know, can make a little money. We out here with soup, jerk chicken, roast breadfruit, and saltfish, and all of them things, you know. So, whole heap of thing, liquor, everything.
So, when COVID did that keep? How you manage?
Boy, We suffer because we never get this. So this come like Christmas to us, you know?
Sunfest every year for me. Every year. As I can see, it's a go on. But if you turn up a little later from this, three or so, fast. Place nice.
So tell us about the reggae bed, because I see you have a reggae bed over there.
Yeah man, a reggae bed there, man. Some reggae bed there. Have a shoe bit come with me, you know. You know when I always want to lay down and sleep, I just lay down and sleep. Holy pack yard board, reggae bed. You know what I mean?
So if I want, if I'm a patron here and I'm feeling tired and I want to sleep, you rent me a reggae bed?
Yeah, no, when I rent, we sell you. Sell the reggae bed, I get one sheet of cardboard, 500. They go find yourself somewhere later and rest.
We have some vendors who are Reggae Sunfest family. There is one lady, or at least two, that have been there from the very first festival. She says, listen, it's Reggae Sunfest, bring up my children.
The restaurants, the nightclubs, you know, everybody, the craft vendors, everybody makes money. From the top to the bottom. So it really is an encompassing festival that everybody participates in. And for back to school in September, it's ideal because it comes in just when people are getting ready to send their kids back to school.
What these festivals have done is to create an all-season Jamaica for visitors and for Jamaicans alike. We depend a lot on these events. Events are important because there is a trickle-down effect. The peanut man, the dressmaker, the hairstylist, everybody makes something. Everybody earns an income from these events. So the festival economy is extremely important, and festivals are important. And Sunfest has certainly impacted on the lives of many because of its longevity and the fact that it's growing from strength to strength.
Reggae Sunfest, it brought a wide range of new customer base to us at Spirits here. Yeah, and I can see the difference in our sales if it wasn't for Reggae Sunfest. So we really endorse it, and we want it to still continue for the next 1,000 years and beyond. Because it's a great show, and as I said, we have seen the improvement in our sales from it.
Reggae Sunfest has a major impact on the Jamaican economy and us. I mean, you have many visitors coming in and they want authentic Jamaican food. Of course, it also benefits hotels, it benefits the craft vendors, the street vendors, so everybody gets a piece of the pie when Reggae Sunfest is in Jamaica. You know?
If you're trying to find a room tonight, the possibility exists that you may not be able to find a room. The hardware stores are making money because they are the ones who people go to if they want to make, to build their, construct their booths. So those people are making money. Pan Chicken Man, where I make money. Transportation, people are making money. And if you try to enter Sunfest International Airport in the days to go pick up someone during Reggae Sunfest week, the line is so long you can't even get into the airport.
The financial benefit of this festival seemed to stretch beyond the borders of Jamaica. In New York City, some travelers flocked to the House of Natural Hair Store to get their Bob Marley hairstyles.
We're getting crazy in the store now because Reggae Sunfest is around the corner. So everybody want to come to this Jamaican spot with their locks and their trusses to get them real nice and beautiful for Reggae Sunfest, because they associate it with reggae. Bob Marley, you know, and most of our reggae artists, they wear locks, so everybody want to come in and get their hair done up to get on their flight all the way to Montego Bay.
My name is Jay Star. I'm here at the House of Natural getting my hair done for Reggae Sunfest.
People come from all parts of the globe and come to events like Reggae Sunfest in Jamaica. You have some who come to Jamaica, find love and get married, and they migrate to the US and other parts of the globe. But similarly, you have other folks who come to Reggae Sunfest and other major events, and they find love and they decide to stay in Jamaica. Some of them are business folks who get married and start successful business in Jamaica. So the economics goes even beyond the monies that are being spent.
I traveled to Jamaica for Reggae Sunfest because it's a one-of-a-kind event. You know, having been to many concerts, dance hall events, reggae events throughout the world. I would say Sumfest is definitely my most favorite. I think the production is amazing, and it's something that I, you know, I look forward to each year. It's something that I would sacrifice for, and I have sacrificed for, in order to attend.
The preparation of the Reggae Sumfest venue takes days and lots of workers. The infrastructures are not merely tents and booths, but they are built and designed just like a typical home.
These booths are built for are here for 2 days, but because of safety, even if they're here for 100 years, even if we decide not to take them down, they're still safe tomorrow, next year, the other year. On Monday morning early, we start taking down most of these, and we're going to store them. So most of the structures are coming down. Those that belong to Downsound go into our storage, and those that belong to the third parties, they pack them up in their trailers and go back to Kingston or Westmoreland or St. Elizabeth, Clarendon, wherever they are from.
And how long that operation?
It usually takes me a week.
A week?
A week. Setting up is the harder part. Taking down is a little more easier.
But we are, as you know, the municipal corporation is responsible for a wide range of things. So among development approvals, and we are the city regulators. So any public events such as these would require permits from the municipality. So our responsibility covers all the structures that are the temporary structures that are erected on site. Safety and security of all patrons. So the disaster evacuation plans that the promoters would have to provide to us to show us that they have put in all the measures to make sure that all patrons are safe. And we coordinate with all the safety departments. So the fire department, the public health department, all those are coordinated because we are also responsible for disaster management and risk reduction. Yeah.
And based on what you've seen here, I mean, we're still a day away from festival.
Mm-hmm.
How does it look? I mean, they're
well,
missing the codes.
Yes, because we have been in and out from day one. All our technical teams, myself, our billing officers, and as you see, the fire prevention team is here as well. So we are coordinating. We have been coordinating with the team, Claudia and everyone, and we are very satisfied with it. As you can. If you have been here before, you can see this year is much improved over the years before. So everything has been stepped up a notch based on, you know, our conversations with the promoters. And so we are quite pleased with what we are seeing so far.
It's going to look completely different. And if you were here in 2019, I don't know if you were or not. Yeah, but 19 was the one that, you know, 20,000 people a night, you know, so. You'll be amazing. So we're on top of technology. We love great production. I have great people working with this team, and we're kind of special, you know. So
you made a grand entrance in 2018. This is when the last time I was here. What can we expect for 2022?
More fire.
Every year we start from scratch because the property doesn't belong to Sumfest. So the structures that are put backstage are removed at the end of the show, and then they come back and they're put in year to year. So what we have is basically tents for dressing rooms, and pending the physical structure, we put in anywhere from 15 to 20 tents. They're floor tents with AC furnished, and those become the artist dressing rooms.
No AC, no event. Literally, no AC, no event.
Wow.
When you see when this thing is planning out, if we go to a tape measure, this is what we're here, this is what we're going to need, 5 AC for that, 4 for that, 3 for that, 2 for that. In total, we need 20 AC, we need 30 AC. And winding down, when they reach the final month, that's that where everything comes down to the T. Now, people start, how are we with the AC? How far you reach? It's like today now, everybody want to know.
It's all about the comfort. We try to have the cleanest bathrooms at a festival, where somebody hands you a piece of paper towel when you finish, and you have to wash your hands, and the floor is kept dry and clean so that the women don't have a problem to use the bathroom, that they're walking in water or anything, and it smells good and feels good. And the food, our vendors are people that we vet very, very carefully. You have to be of a certain standard to be accepted as a vendor on the site. You have to have your food handler's permit. We have to know that you can produce the best curry goat in Jamaica, or the best fried fish, or the best ackee and saltfish, because that's a part of the whole experience.
Okay, my name is Angela Grandison Reed. I'm the Consumer Services Manager at Grace Foods. And today we are setting up for the greatest reggae show in the side of the hemisphere, the Western Hemisphere. And Grace Foods, the authority on food in Jamaica, not only in Jamaica, but the Caribbean and even the world, we are the official food court sponsor of Reggae Sunfest 2022. So we are at the Grace Jerk and Chill Spot, and this is going to be buzzing. It's going to come alive. This is all where the explosion of flavor is going to happen in your mouth, with the jerk being the lead, that authentic taste that embodies the whole Jamaican culture in a bottle. So you come in here to get everything jerk, from jerk, from roasted breadfruit with jerk butter, jerk chicken, jerk pasta, jerk chicken pasta, jerk shrimp pasta, you name it, everything jerk. And it's going to be at the Grace Jerk Chill Spot.
Well, the risk is giving up hope. The risk is stop your vision, you know, cancel your vision. That's a big risk. There's financial risk, of course, and relationship risk. But for me, I'm really about, I believe in the music, and I believe in Jamaica, and I have a track record of delivering and doing the right thing for people, and doing the right thing when it comes to responsible production. You know, we've never had any incidents with any kind of stampedes or violence or anything like that, because people respect this, what we're doing here. We have a lot of respect in the marketplace.
What will my story be now? Cause this one better be good. Tell me, should I tell her I'd
get a confrontation with Robin Hood?
Girl, she told me, I'll be waiting for you, honey. I made something special for you. How am I gonna wait? I can't afford to wait with lipstick stains. I've got to get going. Sing for me. Hey, don't care.
And that is it for the Reggae Sunfest. The preparation for next year's event begins tomorrow. Thank you for watching.
I want to go home.